Hi everyone. I think now you have an idea about plant pathology, which involves the study of pathogen, disease cycles, economic impact, and plant disease epidemiology. All of these studies help to put a strategy for management of plant disease, and this is our main target. To successfully manage a plant disease, it's critical to correctly identify the cause of the disease in its early stages, because delaying of diagnosis can result in extensive crop damage and financial loss to farmers. So we have to study in this lecture plant disease diagnosis, which means identification of the causal agent of the disease. Our outlines include field diagnosis, lab diagnosis, and Koch pustules. A plant pathologist think often about the two questions: what is wrong with my plant, and what can I do to get rid of the problem? It may be too late to help the specific plant when the question is asked, but proper diagnosis may be extremely important in preventing the problem on other plants or in the preventing the problem in the future. So, diagnosis is important to determine the presence and the quantity of the pathogen, to certify seeds and planting materials for certification program, to assess pathogen infecting in plant material in plant breeding programs. Also, it's very important to detect and identify new pathogens rapidly to prevent further spread, to study the taxonomic and relationship of plant pathogens. And it's very important to take plant protection measures, because without proper identification of the disease and the disease-causing agent, disease control measures can be a waste of time and money and can lead to further plant losses. How does a plant pathologist go about diagnosing plant problems? Before start to diagnose the problem, you should know that diagnostician must have very good observation skills, and you must be a good detective. It's important to keep an open mind until all of the facts related to the problem can be collected. And you must consider the possibility of multiple causal factors in the infected area. Diagnosis starts in two steps, or in two stages. First in the field, and followed by the diagnosis in the lab. What can we do in the field? You must firstly recognize the appearance or the normal appearance of plant investigating. Because some plant cultivars have natural yellow to pale green leaves, that means it's normal and don't have any infection. Also, you should note both scientific and common name of plant, because a great variation in susceptibility to a specific disease may occur within different cultivars of plant species. You must consider the possible agents for the infection in this field. And you must also review the culture practices and environmental condition and check for symptoms and signs, and the affected parts of the plant should be noted. Are there symptoms on the roots, leaves, stems, flowers? This is all question can assist in the identification of the problem. To know the identity of the plant species affected, you can utilize various resources that contain lists of plant disease associated with a specific plant. These lists are very helpful in suggesting possible pathogenic agents. An example such a list is found on the American Phytopathological Society, ABS, website. Once you select the plant of interest, you will see a list of bacterial, fungal, nematode, parasitic plants, and viral disease, as well as physiological problems associated with the specific plant. Other source, Westcott Plant Disease Handbook, is useful because specific symptoms are associated with each disease. Other resources are available, which include the APS Press Compendium series on disease and disorders for specific plant species. Now we go to the field which have the infection. We can do 4 steps to collect our information about the infected area. One of the most important things needed, ask many questions related to the host care and culture in order to eliminate or identify possible cause of the problem. First, we must note when was the problem appeared. If the damage caused suddenly or gradually, you must ask the farmer about the seed source and if we have seed treatment and the normal seed germination and the growing stage of the plant. It's vital that a diagnostician ask about the activities that have been conducted around the affected plant. The problem may not be due to anything that the grower has done. The problem could be related to what his or her neighbor has done. Very important, collect information about the growing environment to which the affected plant has been exposed, because environmental factors to include extreme temperature, freezing, rainfall, drought, lighting, and prevailing winds. All of these abiotic factors can be important to the problem. Also, culture and maintenance activities can be significant. What pesticides or other chemicals have applied? And what's the rate and when were they applied? All of this information you can note in the disease severity field notes, and you can keep that to make a continual diagnosis in the lab. Second step in the field diagnosis is knowing the distribution of symptoms on infected plant. Often plant pathologists have to depend on symptoms for identification of disease problem. But really, the use of symptoms alone is often an unuseful method for disease identification, because similar symptoms can be produced in response to different causal agents. For example, some herbicides can cause leaf distortion, which may be confused with viral disease. To know the observed pattern of abiotic agents, that mean non-living agents, you can see a uniform pattern on an individual plant and also observe over a large area due to the abiotic agents. It's important to look for a progression of disease symptoms in plant exhibiting problem caused by non-living agents. If symptoms usually appear suddenly and there is no observable progression of symptoms, this means we have an abiotic agent. But when we see a random symptoms on infected plant and we have also progress to develop these symptoms on infected plant in infected area, that means we have a living agents or biotic agents. The third step in the field diagnosis, check for symptom and sign. Describing the characteristic symptoms exhibited by an infected plant can be difficult to describing over the phone. As a test of this, you may want to take a plant exhibiting symptoms and describe the symptoms that they observe on a sheet of paper. Sign of plant disease agents are the observable evidence of the actual disease-causing agents. That means signs are much more specific to disease-causing agents than are symptoms, and are extremely useful in a diagnosis of a disease and identification of the agent causing the disease. For example, powdery mildew are typically diagnosed by the observation of the gray to white mycelia and conidia observed on the surface of leaves and flowers. Some bacterial disease, you can see also the bacterial oath observed by cutting stems and placing them in water, and you can see the other bacterial oath. The fourth step in field diagnosis is check distribution of symptoms. One of the first things that diagnosticians should note in is how the disease plants are distributed over the affected area. Are they distributed uniformly across an area, or they localized? Is there a definite pattern to the distribution? If you have problem appears in 100% of the plants, it more commonly results from factors such as soil condition, adverse climate factors, temperature, drought, or toxic chemicals. For example, growth regulator, imprior pesticides, air pollutants, and so on. And also, the progression of symptoms on plant in the affected area. If the symptoms all appeared at the same time and there has been no further development of symptoms, this would indicate the possibility of non-infectious problem. Change in temperature, possible improper chemical usage, this is all as an abiotic factor. But if the symptoms started in one area and slowly spread to other areas, and the severity of disease symptoms changed over time, this would be more indicative of the presence of abiotic agents. And the percentage of infected plant is lower than is low, not for all the infected plant. We have here three different type of population level pattern observed with biotic agent. The first one, known as random distribution and observed with seed-borne inoculum, or if inoculum source is very far away, we can see some individual infected plant in infected area. The second one is aggregated distribution, and this is a very common pattern, indicates random distribution followed by spread of disease within host population. And that means we have here a polycyclic disease. We started with the primary inoculum in infected plant, and when pathogen produced the secondary inoculum, spread to neighbor healthy plant and make a new infection and continue around the infected plant to make aggregated distribution of infected plant in infected area. The last figure show us the patch distribution, and this is a very characteristic of fruit infecting pathogen and some problems in the soil type of the infected area. When we finish from the field diagnosis, we need sometimes to take samples and go to the lab to make further tests to isolate and identify the causal agent. Because the symptoms and signs provide enough specific or characteristic information to decide the cause of an infectious plant disease. Here, as you see, we can use the microscopic examination, and we have a different type of microscope to make a examination of causal agent. Maybe we can use the discating and compound microscope to observe of specific spores and the spore structures, and can lead to further identification of possible disease agents. But if we have a virus disease or viroid phytoplasma, we can use the electron microscope to know the size and morphology of the virus particle. The second laboratory tests can we do also incubation of plant material in moist chamber, and this is it's more effective with the biotrophic agents, which need to keep the infected plant alive to continue the infection or to continue for isolation and identification of causal agent. We place infected leaves in a moist chamber, or sometimes we can use also epoxies or big containers to make a moist chamber to continue for the diagnosis and identification of biotrophs. If we have necrotrophs pathogens, which means it can also grow on a dead material, that it's useful to use or to isolate such a pathogen on the nutrient media. And we have various type of the nutrient media which can get the pathogen in pure culture. In some cases where a specific plant pathogen is suspected, a medium selective for the suspected pathogen may be utilized. Fortunately, new diagnostic techniques are now available that require minimal processing time and are more accurate in identifying pathogens. These diagnostics are based on rapid detection of proteins or DNA that are specific to each pathogen. Specific to each pathogen or each disease or conditions. Some procedures require laboratory equipment and training, while other procedures can be performed one side by a person with no special training. For example, here to make identification of virus, we can use some serological tests, for example, ELISA test, or use molecular test, polymerase chain reaction, or PCR test. For the bacterial identification, we can use both also ELISA and PCR, but also we can use the carbohydrate utilization test, known as BioLog. And so on, these all tests help us to make a quickly diagnosis for causal agent of plant disease. All the previous steps can apply with knowing disease, but if you have a new unknown disease, what can we do to determine the causal agent? We must use Koch's pustules. Koch's pustules are seldom conducted for routine diagnosis, but may be extremely important for new disease and for research. We can apply four steps. In each step, we make or collect information about this unknown disease till to reach to know the causal agent of the disease. First, we must note and recognize the symptoms associated with infected plant. And after that, we continue to isolate the organism which may be principles for the infection in pure culture, and for check for the pathogenicity of these isolated pathogens, we must re-inoculate the isolated pathogen in a healthy plant and observe the symptoms come from the infection. If we have the same symptoms as found in infected plant in the field, that means we have isolated the corrected causal agent. If we have other symptoms, that means maybe we have other isolates, or we have we don't have the causal agents in principle for the infection. After check for the pathogenicity test and know the pathogen, we make re-isolate the organism from the infected plant in step 3, and make also a characterization of this pathogen. If this identity for the characteristics of isolate in step 2, that means we have the same pathogen with the same characteristics, and now we are sure for the pathogen, the causal agent for this unknown infected plant, or unknown disease. So at the end, we have now the all information successfully collected, and then extensive testing may be necessary to determine the identification of plant pathogen. We can develop control recommendations and present to grower, and this is point we will discuss about it in the next lecture. See you later, and I waiting for your questions at any time. Thanks.